Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents What Jesus Intended, Finding True Faith in the Rubble of Bad Religion, by Todd D. Hunter. Narrated by Mike Lenz. Foreword. Esau, McCaulley. It is no stretch to say that we live in complicated times. Many Christians are trying to make sense of what it means to follow Jesus in a fractured culture. We are often presented with two alternatives, neither of which is very appealing. Deny the failings we observe within the church, or contend that Christianity is not up to the challenges posed by our age. I am not sure I still qualify as young, but I speak with younger Christians who are inspired by the vision of life presented in the pages of Scripture, but struggle to find that vision take flesh in churches or in the lives of many pastors and clergy. They are dismayed to see that too many of our leaders seem to be more shaped by Fox News or MSNBC than the gospel of Jesus Christ. Wearied by the endless culture wars, they turned to Jesus, hoping to find a better way, only to find the same talking points from outside the church following them inside it, the only difference being that our leaders evoke Jesus to give cover to principles derived from elsewhere. It is a small comfort to know that in some ways we are like every generation of Christians, always in danger of falling into one heresy or another. The church is often tossed to and fro by the winds of culture. We are not unique. Nonetheless, it is helpful to hear from Christian leaders who have direct experience dealing with the church's failings, but have not lost hope that we can be better than we are. Bishop Todd Hunter has given us that in this book. As I worked my way through this book, I knew I was reading the reflections of someone who has asked the hard questions about the church's problems and come out the other side more committed to Christ than ever. The word wisdom is bandied about too easily, but that is a good description for what Bishop Hunter has written here. It is a wise reflection on the person, work, and intentions of Jesus from someone who has spent his entire adult life in ministry, beginning in the Jesus movement of the 1970s to the present day. The answers he gives to our problems are compelling precisely because of the simplicity and clarity born of long reflection. He points the listener to the person of Jesus, asking the most essential of questions. What were the aims of Jesus? What was Christ trying to accomplish in and through the church? Hunter suggests that by discovering those aims and letting Jesus' goals for us and his kingdom take root in our hearts, we can find ourselves and our vocations as followers of the Messiah. According to Bishop Hunter, we do not need to remake Christianity for the modern person. The modern person needs to rediscover Jesus as the solution to the problems and traumas that plague humanity in every age. Do not misunderstand. This is not a close-minded reaffirmation of old-time religion. Instead, Bishop Hunter explores the particular ways in which the aims of Jesus help us chart a path through our current malaise. For example, he asks how the intentions and teachings of Jesus help us deal with cynicism and despair. He wonders how Jesus assists in making sense of the evil done in the name of religion, or how the Messiah helps us wrestle with issues of identity. Listeners will not find solutions that allow us to set aside the difficulties that beset followers of Jesus. Hunter rightly notes that the full solutions to our traumas await Christ's second advent. Instead, listeners will find fresh inspiration to take up again the scriptures and the practices of the Christian tradition and find in them sufficient hope to finish the race that our Lord and Savior set before us. Hunter does not take us to a final destination, but he equips us for the journey. Introduction. From the very first day, we were there, taking it all in. We heard it with our own ears, saw it with our own eyes, verified it with our own hands. The word of life appeared right before our eyes. We saw it happen. And now we're telling you in most sober prose that what we witnessed was, incredibly, this: the infinite life of God Himself took shape before us. 1 John chapter 1, verses 1 through 2, The Message. Everyone was amazed. "What kind of man is this?" they said. "Even the winds and the waves obey him." Matthew chapter 8, verse 27, Good News Translation. The surf was spectacularly high. It was the kind of day that brought out the best. Buff, bronzed-skinned surfers with their jealousy-inducing inlaid boards. I was not one of them. I idolized them. Because the waves were so high that day, and being young, I was body surfing, barely keeping my head above the sea surface by treading water intensely. I, and millions of other church-going people, have often felt the same way. Swamped by church hurts, smothered by bad religion, we employ lots of intense effort to avoid drowning spiritually. In the menacing ocean, my toes did not trust that my head's position above the water was sustainable. With a mind of their own, my feet became a GPS system, frantically recalculating their route as the churning sea ruled my body, commanding it to move in fitful directions. As each unsure, ungrounded moment passed, as if they had a brain, my feet, thrashing and pushing downward frantically, were questing, "Where is the bottom?" My feet were like a bodily expression of a spiritually troubled heart. Will I finally be overwhelmed by my troubles with faith? Is there a way out of this monstrous set of faith-killing waves washing over me? In instance of spiritual trouble, I desperately need and look for a place to stand. I need some secure, solid ground that provides me the ability to maneuver out of my terrible, fearful disquiet. Experience had taught my boyish feet to believe in, rely on, and long for the safe, stabilizing sand of the ocean floor. My toes knew that sand contained the mental and emotional properties of rock, on which a boy could make his stand against the primordial power of the ocean. Today, the sand of faith seems not sturdy, shifting under the feet of faith-challenged people, making their spiritual stance unsure and insecure. Gallup says that only 31% of Americans have a great deal or quite a lot of confidence in the church, and that while confidence in the church has been slipping for many years, it went down 6% in just 1 year. Furthermore, Gallup reports declines in formal identification with a religion, self-reported membership in a church, self-reported religious service attendance, personal importance of religion, and a decline in belief in God. Justin Gibney articulates the thinking of many people concerned about church. To be fair, we must acknowledge the injustices and sins that have caused so many to leave the church and rebuke Christian orthodoxy. They're rebelling against rules wielded with prejudice and malice that continue to bludgeon women and racial minorities. They're responding to structures that cover up abuses of power and morals that are enforced discriminately. They're rejecting religious institutions that serve white supremacy, support misogyny, and mistreat same-sex attracted people, all while claiming a biblical basis. Such harshness and hypocrisy have led to one of the biggest lies of our age, that a person cannot be orthodox, upholding historic Christian doctrine and morals, and also compassionate. The troublesome headlines of fallen leaders and bad religion, along with personal negative experiences in church, leave many so tossed about that they become de-churched. Victims of leadership malpractice and spiritual abuse in the church feel battered and carried away by contextual forces over which they have no say. With similar reactions, many have found themselves in the path of the sexual, verbal, emotional, and other forms of abuse being uncovered in the church. They feel spiritual stress analogous to what I felt in the waters of Big Surf, fear manifesting itself in a racing mind of religious confusion, shallow breathing that ousts spiritual peace, a sky-high heart rate of churchly nervousness. In those moments, we frantically search the surface of the water, right and left, for a spiritual friend bobbing along near us, for anyone or anything that could provide assurance that my bad religious experience could be survived. Bobbing along, too. Over a lifetime of faith, I have a few times been tempted to distance myself from, or even quit, religion and church. My wife and I, after spending decades in Christian leadership, had a period of a couple of years we now affectionately call our de-churched era. We tried several churches, but nothing healed our scars or fed us with hope for sustainable spirituality. The most consistent thing we could do in that era was to cling to the weekly fellowship of a small, contemplative home group focused on spiritual formation. These fellow seekers kept the thread of faith moving through the fabric of our life. But in hindsight, I can see how easy it is for that thread to get yanked and pulled all the way out of one's life. In the same way that two body surfers are in the waves together, you and I will be bobbing along together in this book. I see you. I get you. I perceive you straining spiritually to keep your head above water. I see a similar, widespread reality in countless others via conversations I have had with religious leaders of all denominations who are profoundly discouraged with various aspects of the church. These people cover the organizational chart of church leadership: home group leaders, Sunday school and youth workers, pastors, administrators, women's and men's program leaders, members of vestries and boards, parish council members, professors and deans, and denominational leaders of every level. No category or type is immune. Bad religion hurts. Let's define a key concept. When I say bad religion, I do not have in mind the 1980s Los Angeles punk band by that name. I use the phrase as an imaginative and evocative way to represent the various ways things go wrong in church life. Church hurts from bad religion are accompanied by a profound sense of loss. They hurt more than most of life's other hurts. They sometimes feel on par with divorce or even death. I know for me, church hurts were personal, deeply internal, at the core of my soul. Bad religion is confusing, depressing, and sidelining. I sometimes wondered if I could survive church. Happily, so far, so good. I've hung on as a sincere follower of Jesus. But, truth be told, messed up religion has more than once pushed my face to the sand and held me under its power longer than I was comfortable, longer than I thought I could survive. Feelings of discouragement, despair, hopelessness, irritation, and even anger accompanied these moments. We sometimes fear we have given our hearts, our very lives, to something that, at net, is harmful to humanity. We wonder, similar to victims of abuse, if there is something wrong with us, that maybe we bring these things on ourselves. The sustained experience of bad religion is a complex, layered, nuanced harm. I have real empathy for those who are deconstructing elements of their faith. Such eras of spiritual life can, once on the other side of them, lead to constructive growth. The progress of a pilgrim is always the goal of my spiritual life. I have pursued this progress by staying on the path marked by the person and work of Jesus. I have survived by constantly making my way back to Jesus, to the nature of his being, his words, and his works. A life preserver. The big idea of this book is that it is possible to survive the waves of bad religion. The round, orange life preserver I am throwing out is constructed by the aims of Jesus. There is, I have found, salvation by clinging to that which Jesus self-consciously pursued. When I have been bowled over in the turbulent water of bad religion, flailing and floundering, Jesus is the rock on which my spiritual feet have found secure footing. I continually seek to come back to him as the one about whom amazed disciples marveled, "What kind of man is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him." Matthew chapter 8, verse 27. Jesus' followers would later come to see that in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell. Colossians chapter 1, verse 19. And that he is the only one who has preeminence. Colossians chapter 1, verse 18. Who is above all. John chapter 3, verse 31. Who is teacher and Lord. John chapter 13, verse 13. Who is heir of all things, through whom God made the universe. Jesus is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. Hebrews chapter 1, verses 2 through 3. Jesus has sustained me. He is the animating source of my belonging to and service of the church. Nothing in the contemporary ills of the church should eclipse this truth. Alignment to the aims of Jesus is fundamental to Christian spirituality. Pursuing alignment with the aims of Jesus is the path on which we discover good religion, find the true and good life, and become humanity as God intended. About this book. The stories I tell about others in this book are real, emerging from real conversations with real people. However, to protect their privacy, I have changed the names and contextual details surrounding the stories. In the telling of my own stories, I have done similarly. I narrate my real experiences without naming names or describing specific contexts that could inadvertently identify others. The chapters to come will give a vision for and explain how I have kept my head above water as the deep disappointments of church life rolled over me. Come with me now as we talk straightforwardly about bad religion and the cure for it found in the aims of Jesus. 1. Am I the only one who thinks this? How the church failed us. These religious leaders tie together heavy packs that are impossible to carry. They put them on the shoulders of others, but are unwilling to lift a finger to move them. They forget about the more important matters of the law, justice, peace, and faith. They look beautiful on the outside, but inside they are full of dead bones and all kinds of filth. Matthew chapter 23, verses 4, 23, and 27. Common English Bible. Woe to you, experts in religion, for you hide the truth from the people. You won't accept it for yourselves, and you prevent others from having a chance to believe it. Luke chapter 11, verse 52. The Living Bible. Monica's parents were relentless churchgoers. Only Christian music played in her home. Movies rated R were not just disallowed, they were unthinkable. Monica was raised on the power and goodness of love. And then, in her senior year of high school, her parents divorced in a hailstorm of violent verbal battles. Heavy weights of relational tension crashed into Monica's life, wrecking the joy of her graduation. Because the divorce was so expensive, going away to college was in jeopardy. She did okay-ish in the aftermath, finding post-trauma wisdom in counseling and in the consolation of friends who stuck by her. Monica later married, only to have her husband leave for someone else who better satisfied his sexual peculiarities. The post-divorce response of her just-turned teenagers was not as benign as hers had been to her parents. Acting out angrily at home, disrespecting school authorities, partying, and abusing substances followed. She could see that her kids were self-medicating, but they were so emotionally distant that she could not get through to them. She hoped the church youth group would help, but her kids were mostly judged and marginalized there, even by long-term friends, because of their reactions to their parents' divorce. Next came years of exhaustion from being a single mom. Monica was constantly forced to decide between paychecks, her kids' daily welfare, and self-care. On a humdrum Tuesday evening in February, with the frail winter light receding rapidly around her, having fought the traffic home, she walked through the garage door into the dark kitchen to discover that the kids were out again without telling her where they'd gone. Monica spattered her keys impatiently on the counter and flung herself, a depressed heap, onto the sofa. The lights were off, and unknown to her, chill-inducing inner darkness was coming. And the next instant, it was like someone pushed a button, and black window shades came rolling down, thickly covering the openings to her soul, vanquishing the ability to see anything, including God. Monica was hurt. She was in the grip of disappointment with religion. But she got up. She was tough. She always got up. She flicked on the kitchen light, ate some leftovers while streaming a bit of her favorite show, and went to bed, hoping the kids were safe. She tried to morph hoping into praying, but that button was broken on the back of too many dashed expectations. Facing church trouble. Lord knows how many times I have tossed churchly keys and thrown myself on the couch of religious despair. I have felt the expansive loneliness of not being able to turn apprehension about the church into prayer. I've been embroiled in the ups and downs of church my whole life. I know how religious sausage is made, both the ingredients and the process. As an insider to the church, I know all the yuck of what we are made of and how we fail to deal with it righteously. Despair, dejection, hopelessness, impotence, irritation, anger, and depression have knocked on the door of my heart with great persistence over a long period of time. To be fair, there are of course wonderful moments in ministry where we see light bulbs of insight shine bright, healing come with its joy, and deliverance from evil relieve the victim and spread hope and peace to their family and friends. However, viewed from any number of angles, the church is in oodles of trouble. Modern forms of media make it impossible for the church to hide her sins, her hypocrisy. The church's easy dismissal or even dehumanizing hate for those she deems to be wrong adds to her failure to look and sound anything like Jesus. Compelling or even plausible reasons to consider faith in Jesus and to attend church are, for many, hard to find. Jesus seems eclipsed by the dark shadow of bad religion. That said, after long years working in the church, both sinning and being sinned against within her, I still believe in the body of Christ, the church. Why? Because I believe in Jesus now more than ever. Jesus summons and establishes the church, his body, the ones elected to keep the movement started by Jesus going. I am captivated by Jesus' intrinsic goodness and his inherent wisdom, and by the fact that his power was always selflessly exercised for the good of others. I am motivated to embrace his movement by the notion that even right now, he is living the most consequential life imaginable as he stewards humanity and all God's creation to its intended fulfillment. I find it stunningly compelling that he invites me and you and unchurched doubters with our sins, reservations, errors, and confusions to be in on that story. It has always been this way. Messed up church is the way it has always been. Church history does not unfold like a series of ups and downs that one might trace on a line graph. Up at the resurrection, down at doubting Thomas, up at the church fathers, down at Constantine, up at the Reformation, down in our day. No, the reality of church life is that it unfolds like train tracks, protracted stretches of both slash and, of simultaneity, of good and bad religion all mixed up together in local churches and in individual people. The problematic elements in the body of Christ have been in place since, with 12 close friends, Jesus roamed Nazareth, Galilee, Judea, and Samaria. That band of followers, and the historic body of which Jesus is the head, has never been perfect. Skeptical onlookers would have always had ample reason to reject Jesus because of the close company he kept. Peter, after protesting that he would never do so, denied Jesus. "There you go," an onlooker might have said. "I knew Jesus' followers were hypocrites." Like angry marketing agents, whose message was not cutting through the clutter, James and John wanted to call down fire on whole cities, who they deemed did not welcome Jesus with enough enthusiasm. I can hear a skeptic saying, "Christians are emotionally unstable and should not be trusted with power." Jesus washed the feet of Judas, the deceiving betrayer, to which someone might respond, "Those friends of Jesus are in it just for the pieces of silver they get out of it." The church does not need to be perfect for the purposes of God to advance. But that is not an excuse for the church to be an agent of darkness or abuse that forces unbelievers to grope for the God who is actually very close. Perfection is not the goal. Rather, the goal is to be people whose lives suggest the plausibility of the Christ story. Different details, same effect. My details are different, yours too, but chances are you and I have struggled in Monica's rough, dark-at-the-bottom water. Many, lots, actually, of my clergy and lay leader friends who once had vibrant faith, who served the church and cared for the needs of others, no longer participate in weekly worship. They remain good people, whom I love. I enjoy their company. I can see that they maintain some sort of private devotion that is important to them. But they are beaten down in faith, battered in heart, and bruised in soul. The latest church scandal now seems to arrive, like Sunday football, every week. Some people follow all the muck and, disheartening to me, rank the scandals for us. For instance, I found the top 10 evangelical sex scandals of 2021. The subheadline read, "The Religion Had a Busy Year." Most every list of top religious news stories of a given year contain at least one salacious story of a fallen pastor. For instance, in the short span of 2020 through 2022, we heard about Brian Houston and Carl Lentz of Hillsong, Ravi Zacharias, Jerry Falwell Jr., and Mark Driscoll. It is depressing in the extreme to hear the latest cover-ups of sexual abuse by high-ranking leaders in the Roman Catholic Church and the Southern Baptist Convention. One Midwest pastor was caught having had sex with a 16-year-old member of his church. A megachurch pastor with a global following, estimated to be between 1.4 million and 5 million people, pled guilty in Los Angeles to charges of sex with minors. #Church2 has been in our face for a while now, which grieves those in the church who have a conscience. Outside the sexual arena, our faith shoulders slump when we are given mental pictures of mass graves of indigenous children who die from neglect or mistreatment at the hands of the church. In a unique form of Christian nationalism, leaders of the Russian Orthodox Church, including Archbishop Kirill, are giving Putin's government core rationale for the war in Ukraine. It is unthinkable that there is any justification for Ukraine elderly, mothers, and children to be sacrificed for a false, utterly un-Jesus-like religious vision. Just before being killed, they were under his care. His priests would have married the women, baptized the kids, and normally would have given last rites to the elderly on a deathbed in a quiet, spiritual home. Now they pray over body parts blown to bits by modern weapons of war, egged on by the worst of bad religion. But that's just the news. Now it gets personal. As a decades-long supervisor of pastors, I have had an up-close view of multitudes of fallen leaders, whose bad religion was manifest in extramarital affairs, drugs, alcohol, stealing money, spiritual abuse, abuse of power, and sexual harassment. Each incidence, considering the real trauma to victim survivors, is a genuine heartbreak. Direct victims and associated victims are left spiritually bleeding in the wake of bad religion. Victims fear they have nowhere to turn to find healing, that if they become whistleblowers, telling their story, the church will re-victimize them in order to protect its reputation. Given all that, only about 22% of Americans attend church weekly, and post-COVID church attendance is down 40 to 64%. Over the past 20 years, average church attendance has shrunk from 137 to 65. A new Gallup poll shows that belief in God in America is at an all-time low, and that this downward trend is driven in large part by young people. I read a recent article that dug deep into the phenomena of young people struggling with faith. The article stated that evangelicals in particular are losing their young in epidemic numbers. Young people resent how politics has shadowed their relationship with God and believe that Christ's lessons of humility, tolerance, and love have been forgotten. The article noted that if young people can't ask honest questions and get decent answers, they will bail on church. One college student said, "Our faith, now synonymous with unwavering support for Donald Trump, is causing many to question how Christians could sell out women, immigrants, black people, indigenous people, people of color, the LGBTQ+ community, and the poor for the sake of political power. Gen Z sees the hypocrisy of Christians today." Another student said, "I've started to think of Christianity as causing more harm than good." The article observed that listening is key. Most young people don't care about religion, but if you have young people trying to grapple with their faith so that they can make sense of it, given the world they experience, you should listen to them. One young man, who had dreamed of being a pastor since he was a child and had prepared throughout university for ministry, said that, "Over the last 5 years, I've done a 180, or at least a 90-degree turn, questioning traditional understandings of God." Among the larger adult population, only 40% of Americans believe God intervenes in human life in response to prayer. Just slightly more than a third of the people in the United States have confidence in the church. Americans are most confident in the military and in small businesses. Pastors not only experience this rejection and observe this shrinkage daily, they also feel it in their gut in two profound ways. One, it is discouraging to work hard with sincere love for others and see dwindling fruit. Two, it is disheartening to pursue Christian virtue, only to have the church turn on you for some political reason. Sadly, forms of abuse flow both ways in church. Just ask any pastor who tried to guide a congregation through the Trump years and the COVID-19 pandemic. Thousands of pastors, members of church councils, and church staffs were hounded and hammered by congregations who could not agree about shutting down worship, social distancing, masks, or vaccines. 38% of pastors ponder leaving the ministry to work somewhere else. In spiritual darkness, with seemingly nowhere to turn, a bright red exit sign beckons. And for many church leaders, the church becomes a reality only in their rearview mirror. In moments when bad religion overwhelms the good, the incoherent confusion gives way to what seems a compelling path articulated by a pop rock lyric from the 1960s. "We've got to get out of this place if it's the last thing we ever do. 'Cause girl, there's a better life for me and you." To exit or not. The temptation to exit church has gripped eras of my life like an irritating itch. "Just leave," the thinking goes, and the annoying, prickling stings will go away. When I was an adolescent, the liberal mainline church my family attended stripped Jesus of anything that made him real. They failed to attribute to him any difference-making power. This anti-preaching almost killed my budding faith. It was like spraying spiritual Roundup onto my searching heart, which, like a tiny shoot, was straining to break through the hard soil of ignorance and cynicism. Religion is so infuriating, in part because it contains incoherent confusions. I experienced this sad, clouding mixture in the Jesus movement of the 1970s, in which I found faith in God. We were known for a lot of talk about and practice of love and grace, as well as the acceptance of my generation's particularities of attitude, mod clothing, and hairstyles. This atmosphere helped us know for sure that God loved and forgave our sexual, drug, and alcohol sins. The disconcerting confusion crept in when I discovered that this love did not extend to everyone. For instance, it was implied that our faction of the church had all aspects of Christian spirituality right. Our spiritual movement was not like those other corrupt denominations that had it wrong. Our interpretations of the Bible were dead on. They contained no ignorance or bias, which meant they were filled with certainty that funded a less than humble, self-assured approach toward others. The smallest difference in doctrinal understanding could be weaponized in the war with the people we heard our leaders and teachers ridicule, individuals like Robert Schuller of the Crystal Cathedral, or whole groups of people like Roman Catholics or mainline Protestants. Later, I encountered the good, the bad, and the ugly of the charismatic and Pentecostal worlds. I have seen amazing miracles of healing and seen the after effect of people being delivered from evil. I have rejoiced with friends who received spirit-empowered, life-changing insight from biblical gifts of the Spirit. Words of knowledge, words of wisdom, prophecies, and discernment. Wow! Amazing! Sadly, something else is simultaneously true. More than a few of the most anointed, spirit-empowered people I have known were also highly manipulative, sexually immoral, and relationally unloving. And they secretly abused various substances, legal and illegal. I've observed leaders using spiritual gifts maliciously and slanderously in order to get their way. I loved and admired the people I am here calling to mind. I frequently wished I were as spiritually gifted as them. But this is also true. I don't think I have ever gotten all the way to the bottom of the crushing, personal disappointment of their public falls from grace. Mulling the effects of bad religion, I was reminded of the inner work of healing I still need from when the hashtag MeToo movement morphed into the hashtag ChurchToo. Churchly messes spilled into public for any open-minded person to see. When these things happen, I again quickly imagine the exit sign as thousands more people give up on church, on religion, sidelining Jesus in their life. Continuing my story, in the late 90s, I participated in many conversations with young Christian leaders who were wrestling with issues of postmodernism. It is true that in some cases, the church had wed herself too closely to elements of modernism that, in hindsight, were not helpful to spirituality in the way of Jesus. To the degree the church was unconsciously in the grip of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.